Good morning, Lipscomb. Who's ready for fall? Yes. We played the Q Union video again because last week we didn't get to give you all of the information. So I'm gonna take a minute to kind of explain some confusion that I've already heard. But I want to start just by reading a couple passages out of the book of Psalms, a couple of verses. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts away. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth, how he makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Be still and know that I am God. Guys, in the midst of a very confusing day, if you watch the news, if you're on social media, if you were watching primetime television last night, you know that there's a lot of questions. There's a lot of confusion. There's a lot of division. And with all that going on, I am most glad for this 1 hour we have a week. This 1 hour that we get to slow down, that we get to be with our friends, we get to reflect on the person of Jesus as a university, we get to remember who we are and why we meet. But for the most part, this 1 hour of slowing down, I think for more than we're willing to admit, more than I'm willing to admit often, is it just gives me a moment to quiet my thoughts, quiet my heart, reflect on the things unchanging, the unchanging nature of God, the sovereignty of God, the goodness and the control of God. And while we have a lot of questions that we're looking for answers to, we know that in the midst of the pursuing understanding, the pursuing reconciliation, the pursuing peace, the pursuing good and just politics, God's going to meet us there. And so, just take a minute, close your eyes, really try and quiet your hearts. I'm gonna say a quick prayer before we start today. Jesus, we come to you confused and hurting. We come to you full of questions, God, for those who are very connected to pain and suffering today, I pray that you'd be their peace. God, for those of us who have questions that we do not think we'll ever find answers to, I pray you will be our understanding. God, for those of us who are placing our trust and our hope in human institutions, God, I pray that you'd be our strength. Help us to be still. Help us to slow down. Help us to focus on you. Amen. All of that brings me to Q Union. I can't say more about the importance of an opportunity like this. You guys, October 13th in Shamblin Theater, there's a slide, if we could put that back up with all the details. October 13th in Shamblin Theater from 7 to 9 p.m., you're going to hear from three global speakers, two political analysts, Ravi Zacharias and Lecrae, all sharing thoughts and conversations about challenging us as believers to engage our culture, to engage in the hurt, to engage in the trouble, to be involved in the conversations, not to be the most right, but to invite people into pursuing truth and peace and justice together. If you haven't marked your calendars, this is a free opportunity. The website is qideas.org/QUnion. You'll be hearing from three of your fellow students along with the national speakers. And we as a university, we just want to recognize there's a lot of hurt today, and we want to chase after that together. And this is the catch. It's the first day of fall break. So fall break, October 13th, you get out of class, stick around. We want to engage some of the most challenging and divisive conversations of today, and we want you to be intentional about being there. Reservations will open up next week. If you have questions, come and see us in the campus ministry office. Moving forward, I want to invite Ken Durham to join me on the stage. We're going to play the short trailer of the Y Chapel theme, and then we're going to hear a message from him in just a moment.
Who, what, when, where, and how are all important questions. This year, as a community, we want to focus on purpose. We want to become people of vision. And we believe that to do this, we have to start asking why. It is the why that fuels us and ignites us with passion. It is the why that fills us with purpose, and it is the why that gives birth to vision. So join us as we explore this question together.
Y'all, this is Ken Durham. He is one of our Bible faculty members. He holds the position of Baxter Chair of Preaching, and I'll let him explain what that means because I don't know fully. I know that he gets to be a father, a mentor, a leader to a lot of us on campus, and we're very grateful for him. So I'm going to pray for him and turn the podium over to him. Jesus, thank you for the gift of your word. Thank you for the gift of community. Thank you for the gift that we have in pursuing some of the tough questions together. God, I pray that you'd prepare our hearts for understanding, prepare our hearts to receive a word that's been cultivating in Ken's heart for a few weeks now. Lord, we just anoint his words, and we ask that you would be very clearly present with us as we dive into the subject of why community. Why people? Why do we need one another? Lord, we bless this man, and we ask that you just be with us as we still our hearts again for another 20 minutes or so. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Cyrus, thank you for centering us this morning. I could tell we were all needing that and responding to that. So, hey, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to the gathering. Nancy, my wife, and I came here about 6.5 years ago from Pepperdine University. People say, why would you leave Malibu for Nashville? And I said, well, look around Nashville and enjoy the fall, which arrived sometime in the last couple of hours, and a million other reasons why we're glad to be here. And I'm proud to be part of this great gathering of Bible teachers, the men and women that compose our College of Bible, many of whom are here today. So, Our theme is why, and I've got a story to tell about that. Some of you have heard me tell it before, but it's just too good. I got to tell it again. I was preaching in California some years ago, and a little boy named Luke Lambert was listening. He was the son of one of the kids of our campus minister. And he turns to his mother, Kim, somewhere in the middle of my sermon. I think it was on the nature of God or some lofty topic like that. And he turns to his mother and he says, "Mom, why?" And thinking that he was, responding, of course, and listening to my message, she launches into some deep parental explanation, at least as much as a six-year-old could gather about, honey, Ken is talking about God who loves us and why God made us and trying to make some sense out of my sermon for him. All the while, he's been munching on a pretzel, and at some point, he looks intrigued by his mother's response, but he looks up at his mother and he holds up the pretzel, and he's eaten all of the pretzel away except for, he says, "No, Mom, why?" There it is. Which confirmed my long-held suspicion that parents and preachers often are answering questions that nobody is asking. But the question today is, my assignment, and I'm really thankful for it, is why community? Why community? Why in the mind of God does this seem to occupy a major space in God's vision for humankind? And so my best answer, I'm going to work with you on this one for the next few minutes, is why community? Because we were made for it. Because we got to have it. We can't live without it. It is essential. It is, we might say, intrinsic to our nature as human beings. So what I want to do in the next few minutes is turn to the first two chapters of the Bible and make an argument from design, from Scripture, which from its earliest pages wants to make the case for the indispensable place of relationships in your life and mine from the very beginning. If we are to flourish as God's creatures, to mature, to thrive, to live up to his creative intent, relationships are absolutely and completely essential. Do you know the name Barbara Streisand? I assume you've heard it. She's still in the top 10 of all the best-selling female vocalists of all time. She's won a bunch of Grammys and a bunch of Emmys. She lived about 5 miles from us, away from us, in Malibu. Now, I never saw her. She never seemed to frequent the same Jack in the Box that I like to go to. But she was our famous neighbor, and she had this song. It was her signature song that she recorded, and the name of the song was People. Maybe you've heard it somewhere along the way. And it says very simply, people who need people are the luckiest people in the world. And it's a great sentiment. It seems to suggest that if we recognize our need for people and we live in that recognition and we do something about it, we're lucky, we're blessed. But if I were to correct Barbara and make it even more true, I would say people who need people are the only people in the world. If you're a people, you need people. And the reason I think so is because the Bible tells me so. So I'm looking at Genesis 1. I'm looking at the story of the creation of all good things recorded in Genesis 1 and 2. And as you begin to read through this most ancient and most lovely of pictures of how humankind came to be, so different from all the other legends and myths and accounts of the beginning of all things, this is more of a song. This is more of a melody, which introduces us to a creator whose word was so dynamic, so effectively powerful, that all that he has to do is speak, and it's so. And so, in the Genesis account of creation, God says, light, and there is light. Sky, and there's sky. Seas, and there's seas. And living creatures, and there are. And with each segment of creation, there is a chorus, a repeated sentiment. It is God's evaluation of his creation. And it comes in a single word, a single restrained, reticent, reserved review of creation, and the word is good. Somebody said one time, isn't it interesting that in our world, you know, toilet paper dispensers and laundry detergent, those are awesome, but when God looks at the world and all that's in it, God says, good. But not because God's saying, I do good work, don't I? Wow, that's pretty impressive. I think I just impressed myself. What he is noting is his nature stamped upon his creation. The nature of God, the essential nature of God, is his goodness, and what he created, you included, shares in that goodness. Well, we come to the next chapter then, and there's all of a sudden a break in the rhythm of creation in Genesis 2. The Creator has created now a human being. Adam, we call him. It just means human. And he's placed him in the loveliest of settings, a perfect garden, or at least it seems to be perfect. It doesn't turn out to be perfect for the moment. Because a few verses later in Genesis 2, we can bring that up, suddenly this rhythm is broken with this dissonance, this negativity that for the first time appears in God's world. God pronounces something not good. Not good. Wait, but not good? I thought this was paradise. I thought this was perfection. No, apparently not. And what's not good, and the whole, seems to me, the whole flow of this narrative, the way it has come down to us, is to set up this dramatic moment. What's God going to do? Something's not good. What's God's response? Did God just flub the dub? Did he just make a mistake? Did he say, oops? Or has he created a moment of dramatic revelation so he can create something so essential that we have already found out that without this, the world can never be good? Well, he says, first of all, okay, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to create a helper. There is no helper in the world, at least not among humankind, and that's not good, and I'm going to do something about it. But first he does something strange. He says to Adam, to the man, he says, okay, we're going to do this helper thing, but first of all, we're going to name some things. And so there's this odd picture of God seemingly parading all creatures, all living creatures, under Adam's nose, and Adam's assignment is to give a name to it. And so Adam's got to pull out of his, you know, creative instincts names for all these funny-looking things. Aardvark, I wonder how he came up with that, but that was actually pretty good. And so finally his assignment is completed, and now God is ready, and again the drama builds because the text says, but for Adam, among all these living things, there was no helper, no suitable helper for him. Now look at this word helper for a second. In the Hebrew, it's pronounced azer. It is a word most often in Scripture used to describe God. Of the 21 times it occurs in the Old Testament, 16 times it describes God as our helper. So I like to say, when I'm doing premarriage counseling, as I was with a couple just a few weeks ago, guys, when it says that the woman that God has given you is to be your helper, that is not a diminutive thing. That's not a put down. That's not certainly an inferiority place. If anything, it is to give to her a designation of importance that we usually look to God himself as. God is our helper. Unto the hills I lift up my eyes. From whence comes my help? My help comes from God, the psalm says. And so the idea is of someone, in a military context, it would mean the person who brings the necessary reinforcements. You've run out of water, you've run out of food, you've run out of whatever it is you need most, and you can't do what must be done without the helper. And so with this as a setup, God creates Eve. God gets down to business. Help has arrived, and her name is Woman. Woo-hoo. And Adam's response is wonderful. It says, and in the Hebrew it's more powerful than it usually comes out in most translations, Adam says, "At last, at last, finally, yeah, that's what I'm talking about. This is what the world has been missing." Adam got it. He knew he needed help. He needed another person in his life for their strength and their perspective and their counsel and their humor and their admonition and their forgiveness, lest he be forever incomplete. So there it is. That's my argument from design. This has been called the first wedding, but I prefer rather to call it the birth of community. As we become aware in the most dramatic way imaginable that this is how God wired you, this is how he programmed us, this is how he DNA'd us to function and flourish in his world as part of community. We need one another. So my word to you today, under the heading of Why Community, is be an Azer. Be a helper. It's true, you and I need community to flourish, but turn that around. You and I are needed. The community needs you because you bring something to the party that nobody else does. This broken world needs your voice, needs you to contribute with your peacemaking, your gifts of music or sport, or pharmacy, or leadership, or engineering, or healing. Yes, especially your ability to participate in the healing of a broken world. Cyrus reminded us that we are in the midst of a time of, it seems, especially intense brokenness and need of healing. And this is where the Azers, show up and do what God created you to do. See, your determination to be an agent of peacemaking brings healing to the world. It's one of the most really startling things Jesus said, that your determination, my determination, to stop in the middle of all the good things we're doing, even the holy things we're doing, and make it right with a brother, heal the breach with a sister, is as important as even, or maybe it's the same as, your worship of God. He says in Matthew 5, if you're on your way to worship God, what could be a higher priority than that? Literally, he says, if you're on your way to present your sacrifice at the altar, and you suddenly remember somebody has something against you, hard to imagine, but it happens. Maybe you have created this breach. Maybe you have created this tear in the social fabric. And before you go and do your business with God, Jesus says you do your business with your community, with your brother, with your sister. You leave your sacrifice at the altar, you go and work out a reconciliation with that person, and then you are ready to make an offering to God. That's community building. That's friendship. The community needs you, and you need the community. You are not made for aloneness. Sure, we all need some solitude now and then, but not isolation, not loneliness, not friendlessness. And I was reminded recently, I was sitting at Edley's with our wonderful group of campus ministers, and we were talking about the needs that they're seeing in you and the things that you're dealing with. And a younger and more perceptive person than myself described the feeling of sitting alone in your room on a Saturday night, scrolling through Facebook pictures of hundreds of people having a wonderful time and wondering if you're the only person on the planet who isn't. The dark side of social media, you might call that, I guess. But there are even deeper crimes against what Dr. Martin Luther King called our beloved community, or our notion of a beloved community. That, I think, was his understanding of God's vision for community, a world at peace. Dr. King called it the beloved community that God wanted to shape and to bless. And I thought, as I wrote this down last night, I thought of April 4th, 1968. I went up on the roof of High Rise with several of my friends who were residents there in that then brand new residence hall, you can imagine. April 4th, 1968, and we looked out over Nashville, and everywhere we saw downtown in the downtown area, there were fires. And I knew that Dr. King had been shot that day in Memphis by a man named James Earl Ray, and I thought, what a terrible thing. But I didn't understand the response of the Nashville community, of so many people that wanted to do something to protest this awful murder, this awful breach of peace in the life of a peacemaker. And I was so ignorant and I was so naive, and so much of my experience of the world then as a Lipscomb student was to be willfully ignorant of the civil rights struggle that was going on in my country at that time. But now we can't not be aware of some of those same malignancies, those forces of hate and discrimination and racism that threaten to tear apart the social fabric of our country along seams of not only race, but immigration and gender identity. And we recognize that there's so much hurt in our community, in our larger community, that defies God's best efforts to create a beloved community. And so from Charlotte and from Milwaukee and from Baltimore and Dallas and go back to Ferguson and beyond, we feel the strain, we feel the pain, we feel the frustration, we feel the terror. And what is our best response? Well, surely it has to start as close to home as we can make it. As someone asked this question, would a multiplication of my heart to all hearts bring to the world peace or war? What do I bring to the party? What spirit of community building do I contribute to the challenge of here and now? What will we do? It seems to me is a question that should hang over us these days, not only when we cast a ballot in a few weeks, but when we walk into a dorm room or we go out to do the work we do outside this campus, and especially when we leave this place and take the resources that have been so plentiful and so accessible here and do something with them in a broken world. If we're committed to growing in the values of friendship, community, of relationship, of love, we know, don't we, that we're going to have to put ourselves out there. We're going to have to extend ourselves. We know there is a cost to be counted. We know that, right? We know that whether it's simply becoming a friend or healing a breach in what once was a friendship, or moving beyond our comfort zone into relationships with people very much unlike ourselves, that always it is an expensive venture. It's a risky business. Of course it is. It was God's most expensive venture. For God so loved this community that he gave his best and his brightest to provide a healing, a redemption, a reconciliation. Why should we expect it to come to us without a price? I've never heard it said better than it was said by C.S. Lewis. I offer this for your consideration this morning as you decide how much you want to invest of yourself in the lives of other people. To love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything in your heart will be wrung and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give it to no one, not even to an animal. You wrap it around carefully with hobbies and little luxuries. You avoid all entanglements. And you lock it up, your heart, safe in the casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. The only place, Lewis says, outside heaven where you can be perfectly safe from all the dangers of love is hell. To love is to be vulnerable. If you want to be a helper, if you think this is important, and I hope you do, then you may need to be thinking this morning of how you're going to get some help. If you want to get better at friendship, if you want to work through some interpersonal conflicts that just seem to be unworkable, if you want to overcome your shyness and your seeming inability to extend yourself to other people, then get some help. We got helpers around here. We're good at assembling helpers. At Lipscomb, we got campus ministers. We got Cyrus and Nicole and Steve and Jamie. We got great people at the counseling center. We got faculty members and staff members around here who would love to go to coffee with you, you know, or Copper Kettle, or Jen's Ice Cream. Find a person that might give you a few moments and share your need to grow as a member of community and see if you don't bless them as much as you bless yourself in them. Why community? Because you're going to need it. You're going to need it like I needed it that day I found out I had lost all the hearing in one ear. Boom, all of a sudden, never to return. And my friend said to me, "Oh, that's okay. We'll just talk a little louder. And which side is your good side? We'll walk on that side of you from now on." You're going to need it like I needed it when my dad died. I had been away from here for several years. I was involved in ministry in another part of the country, but I went back to South Carolina for my dad's service. And that night at his wake or his visitation, I looked at the other end of this big room at the funeral home. I watched the door open and my four best friends from Lipscomb walked in. I didn't know they were coming. Four guys lived in other parts of the country. They just showed up the night I was preparing to bury my dad. You're going to need it like I needed it when I went through a divorce. My greatest life failure so far. And a church gathered around me and loved their divorced, humiliated preacher. And stuck with me and prayed for me until I remembered how to pray again. May God bless you this school year with the building and the nurturing of what in the Genesis sense we might call good friendships, good relationships. Good because you have determined to invest yourself in other people with your listening, with your support and affirmation and honesty and goodwill, with your vulnerable love, so that whether it comes in a few months or years from now, when this stage has been moved to the back of this space and I think it's a little higher on that particular day. You walk across this stage, or one very much like it, to claim your diploma. You will be better equipped spiritually and intellectually to be a helper, to be a builder of community in this broken world, to give it something only you have to give. I close with these good words from another of my favorite writers, Frederick Buechner, who said, "The grace of God means something like this. Here's your life. You might never have been, but you are, because the party wouldn't have been complete without you." And of course, we all know you can't party alone.
Thank you, Dr. Durham. Let's stand and have one song together.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the the day when the face shall be sad, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the horn shall descend. Even so, it is well.
Seated, have some announcements from our SGA president, Jackson Smith.
Thanks, guys. Really quick, just thank you so much, Dr. Durham. That was really awesome. It takes a lot of courage to get up and talk in front of people. It takes a lot more to be vulnerable the way you were, so we really appreciate you. Really quick, I want to give some announcements on behalf of the SGA. Before that, I want to clarify something from the last time I was up here. To the girl that asked me on the date via Twitter, I still haven't gotten that call. I'm waiting for it. And so, yeah, just looking out for that. Really quick, that's a really dumb joke. I'm sorry. Really quick, I want to give some announcements of stuff coming up this week. We've got a pizza party for the Nashville Navs. If they have the slide, throw that up there. So Navs are excited about it. Just an awesome group of students on campus that are really seeking the Lord. And if you're interested in that, looking for some new community, go out to their meeting on Wednesday at 8:30. They're going to have free pizza there. This Friday, we've got an awesome event coming up. Drew Holcomb is coming and is going to play behind the bell tower. Let's give it up for Drew. Yeah. It's gonna be a lot of fun. The music starts at 5:30. Drew comes on at 7. So come out to that. Bring a blanket. Bring your friends. If your family's in town for family weekend, invite them to come out. We would love to have them too. It's gonna be a really fun show. On Saturday at 7, we have the Cowboys show, and that's coming on. So who knows how that will go? Maybe it'll be okay. We'll see. And then one last thing that I want to tell you guys about is something that SGA has had a really cool opportunity to partner with, and that's some students that have they've been working with Room at the Inn. It's a homeless shelter downtown in Nashville. Last year, we hosted 6 Saturday nights. We hosted 10 men for that. This year, we're getting ready to host 14 Saturday nights starting in November, running all the way to March. And it's just been so awesome to see the way that the Lord has guided that, and the Lord has allowed students here completely student-run, student-organized, student-served, to just be able to serve those people and grow and love those men. So if you're interested in that, be looking at your emails, be checking social media. We're going to be posting about that to have some volunteer sign-ups. But if that's something you feel called to, like, come find me, come find Macy Cottrell, and we'd love to talk to you more about that. And then the last thing, if you'll just throw that slide up. Follow us on social media. If you want to keep in the loop of the stuff that SGA is sponsoring and the stuff that's going on campus, we would love to have you plugged in with that. We'll have some drawings and different stuff pretty soon if you follow those things. So those are all announcements I have, and I'm just going to pray. So if you will, just please join me. Dear God, you are so good, and we thank you so much for just this day and what a blessing it's been. It's truly beautiful outside. And it's not 100 degrees anymore, and I thank you for that. God, I just pray that you allow us to receive all of the words that you've given to us today through the gathering, and if there's words that were not meant for us, I pray that you let them just bounce off of us, but the words that were for us, I pray that you you let those just receive those deep in our hearts, God. Thank you so much for Dr. Durham and his vulnerability and his love for you. God, I just want to pray that you send us out today to serve and to be your hands and your feet. In a world with a lot of questions and a lot of confusion, especially right now. And I just pray that you help us to embrace that and find identity in your all-encompassing love, God, and the love that you root into us. So I just thank you so much for who you are. I thank you so much for the blessing that that you are to us and that your son Jesus, and because of his life and his death and his resurrection, his life again, that we get to just be a part of your family. We love you so much, God, and I need to pray. Amen. Guys, be dismissed. Have a great week.